Welcome back, dear viewers. As we promised, we are going to commemorate the anniversary of the Islamic Battle of Badr, which took place also on Ramadan 17th, to shed more light on this battle and the lessons we should learn from it along the years, decades, and even centuries. We are very much delighted to have with us live here in the studio Dr. Usama Youssef, our scholar and researcher at Al-Azhar Al-Sharif. Thank you very much for being with us, sir.
Thank you.
First, happy Ramadan to you.
Happy Ramadan for you and all of your family. And thank you so much for having me.
And we are going to start immediately Badr, the very first Islamic battle. And there were, of course, a lot of preparations. But before we go into its details, Muslims do not do something like that or go into a battle without the permission of God and without a very direct permission of God, and for one reason, just to regain the rights, not as an aggression. Would you please elaborate on that?
Sure. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always give the people in the Muslimin the chance to, as you said, regained. Or we are not like a people who also start with
strikes or attacks.
Yeah, or unjust any person. Mm-hmm. Battle of Badr is one of the most important battlefield in the era of Muslimin. Mm-hmm. And it's called Badr because of the name. His name is Badr. And this is a well of he digged the wall, his name is Badr. Mm-hmm. And Badr was in a place between Medina and Mecca. Mm-hmm. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he does not have intention to invade or to have a battle for al-mushrikeen mm-hmm. at all. He wants just to have obstacle for the tribe or a caravan that Abu Sufyan was led at that time. But what was happening in that time, Abu Sufyan knows that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will come and interfere and obstacle the caravan. So what he did? He changed the way already.
Yes.
But in that time, there is a spy was knowing the matter. Like Abu Sufyan knows that the Prophet will come. He changed the way, as he said. And then there is a person, his name is Dumama, went to Quraysh to tell them. Okay, he was a little bit drama, Dumama, because what he did, he cut the nose of his horse and said to Rasul, said to the people of Quraysh, come help, come help. Mm-hmm. And the people of Quraysh, like when they see Dumama and see everything, they make like, they prepare for a southern fighter.
Yes.
To go to Badr and then to have the battlefield or to fight Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Abu Dumama, when he went to them and told them the news, Abu al-Hakam was the leader of al-Mushrikeen, the disbeliever at that time. And then he knows already in al-Hulayfa that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not interfere anything. He failed to obstacle the caravan. But Abu al-Hakam said, no, wallahi, he swear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will stay 3 nights just to show the all other tribes that the Quraysh is very strong and they don't care about anything mm-hmm. and show the power. So what he did in that time, he stayed in bed for 3 nights. He has like every day, as a scholar said, he has like, he slaughtered 10 camels.
Yes.
And he has like a dancers and singer as like, yeah, everything.
He made it a safari.
Yes,
as if
safari.
Did a picnic. Yeah.
You are right.
Yeah.
So when he did this, the Rasulullah ﷺ started by talking with his companion. What do you think about this issue now? What should we do? And in that time, as I told you, like Rasulullah ﷺ does not have any intention, but in the same time, al-mushrikeen was 1,300, as a scholar says. Well, mu'mineen, the faithful, 300 only. Mm-hmm. So now it's a big difference in numbers, and they don't have like, they have all the
battle equipment, the weapons, everything.
They have everything. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but is always, and this is a very great lesson we can take from Battle of Badr.
Yes.
It's not with your equipment, it's not with what you have. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you more than even your resources. Because Allah, innama, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the Quran, innama amruhu iza arada shay'an an yakuna lahu kun fayakun. When he say be, it's be, automatic.
But do your homework first,
yes,
and continue with preparing, and then ask God Almighty for help. You are going to take this help.
Allah, the Prophet ﷺ did exactly what you said, which you would call it like tie a camel.
Yes.
You cannot just go haphazard. Mm. So what is the Prophet ﷺ did in the night before the battlefield? He was supplicate so much to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even he tears to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him victory. Mm-hmm. Someone can tell me like, okay, this is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If he say anything to Allah, if he say any supplication, Allah give him victory. Mm-hmm. Why now he supplicate and say, Ya Allah, يعني, be with us and to do his, as you said, he tie his camel. That is his homework he
and
should do.
And we're also tactics, sir.
Yeah,
and
sure.
To have Hamza on the front, for example, to be an example and a role model for the others. Would you please give us more details about how to prepare?
Yeah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yeah, the first he makes supplication, which is spiritual stuff. After this, he want to do actual stuff. So what he did, the first technique, the Arab at that time, they are make a battlefield with skar wa far. They just gather and like, you know, like
and flee, gather and flee.
Yes. Yeah, that's their technique.
Yep.
But in that time, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam make it as when you go to the masjid, like a straight, a straight line. Even there is a very like incident that happened when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was making the straight line with his cane. Then one of the companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he bugged him, but like just to make the line to be straight. Mm. He said, Ya Rasulullah, darabtani fa awja'tani. You punish, يعني, like this is, you've
beaten me, yeah, and it hurts.
Yeah, it hurts me.
Yeah.
Rasulullah said to him, like, okay, so what do you want now? He said, like, I want to take a revenge, like to do the same as you did. So Rasulullah took a part of his cloth, and then he gave him the cane to beat him. Once a person see this incident of Rasulullah ﷺ, he go and hug him. Mm-hmm. He say, Ya Rasulullah, I know that if anyone touch your body, he will never enter the hellfire. Yeah. So you see, like, this is how the companions was even have this great like hikmah, wisdom, and also great love to Rasulullah ﷺ.
Sure.
So Rasulullah ﷺ, as I said, do this for a first time that the Arab never even know about this.
So unfortunately, sir, we do not have much time, but we should go forward for another lesson. Even after being that much victorious and after proving that Allah was there with them and with the believers, the Muslims did not deal in a bad way with the war prisoners. They dealt great, and they sent a message of peace even after being victorious over those unbelievers. Would you please elaborate?
Yeah, we always, like, even in our fight, we have etiquettes.
Mm-hmm.
Etiquettes of war. Like, we have the etiquette. We cannot like cut a tree, or we cannot like kill a child, or we cannot like the people who are weak, you know. Even as you say, in a prisoner of war, how you give them the rights also is not like, okay, as we see, like sometimes the people took a prisoners of war and like, you know, do something not good to them. No, we have etiquettes as a Muslim in the fighting. We have etiquettes in a peace. We have etiquette, as I told you in the beginning. We don't want any, like, the Rasulullah himself in this battlefield, he does not want to shed like a blood, or he does not want
at all. And to add to this, there was this very wise decision. If any of the war prisoners was able just to teach a Muslim how to read and write, then he is free.
Yes.
This is to send another message how much education, how much reading and writing was very essential for Islam since the very first year.
Because also we are the Ummah of Iqra, we are the nation of Iqra. The first verse in the Quran was Iqra. We are always urge people to read, and also, like, if there is a peaceful way to do stuff, mm-hmm, we always go to this peaceful way, not to go to the harm, like a hard way or like a bad way, you know. Mm-hmm. So this is the etiquette of a Muslimin. Another lesson also from the Battle of Badr we can take is like how to always, as we say, prepare, but also to always leave the matter to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have a certainty in Allah.
Mm-hmm.
Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this battlefield, he does not look only for what he had, but he also has a big certainty in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we take it nowadays, like, you can, for example, some people have, for example, an exam in college or faculty or whatever, and then he can do very good homework, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not give him guidance. At the end of the day, you need to do your part and leave the other part to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and make sure that if you do your part very good, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will
It's an equation.
Yes, and Allah Allah will never leave you and give you, inshallah, the victory.
Sir, we need such a recipe for the coming 10 days, because just in 3 days we are going to enter those very precious nights and days of the holy month of Ramadan. In brief, just in points, what to do?
Yeah, as we, alhamdulillah, we can continue contemplating the Holy Quran. Mm-hmm. Not just read. Read the Quran is great, but also to understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to tell you from this Quran is great. It's mm-hmm. more like even rewardable, inshallah. The other thing, to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Go like at night, and if the people go to tahajjud or people like at their houses, always pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of us need something from Allah. Mm-hmm. So this is a night that you can always pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and cry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you what you want. You want for your children, you want for yourself, you want for your work. And this is the season, you can do it. The other thing is, keep going, keep doing your taraweeh prayer. Keep going your a'mal, charitable acts. Mm-hmm. If a person, for example, and also like zakatul fitr mm-hmm. will be in this, and also the matter of to search for Laylatul Qadr, which is more important, it's very important layla.
Khayrun min alf shahr, better than 1,000 months.
Yes.
Dr. Osama, we do have a lot to speak about, so we are going to leave you, sir, with a promise to see you again in other
Inshallah.
Episodes to continue what we have started.
Inshallah. That's
Thank
my
you
honor.
Very much, and happy Ramadan.
Thank you so much.
We were very much delighted to have with us live here in the studio Dr. Osama Youssef, scholar and researcher at Al-Azhar Al-Sharif. Well, by this we come to the end of this episode of our breakfast show. Stay tuned on Nile TV International always for more updates, and for more details please log on to www.nileinternational.net. You are in the company of my dear colleague Amal Mukhtar and myself Nirmina Abdurrahman. Many thanks. Oh.